Good evening and welcome everyone back to FractalU.com. Tonight we have an exciting course on the sacred geometry of the Philosopher's Stone and the science and practice of alchemy with our special guest, Paul Harris, who is with us. And I am personally excited to hear Paul's presentation because I have a lot of fun with the theory. But Paul, in addition to theory and history, is a hands-on kind of expert in this field of alchemy and the real spiritual meaning of alchemy, along with the scientific principle and the hands-on practice. So I think this is going to be exciting and wonderful, and Paul has prepared exciting visuals which are in front of us. I'm going to do about a 3-minute intro here, and then I'm going to turn it entirely over to Paul. So my intro here to this science of alchemy is to try to set just a little bit of context, but Paul can take this anywhere he wants. And that intro was from our previous series here, fractalfield.com/alchemyoffusion. There were two short stories I wanted to tell. One was, we believe that when John Dee's study of the geometry of the hypercube, which you remember is in a sense dodeca and implosive, became the design for Shakespeare's cube octa theater design. So Shakespearean theater was cube octa for a reason, which was to set up the phase conjugate wave conditions for an implosive alchemic fusion oneness experience, because even, for example, in Midsummer Night's Dream, the sequence of emotions are pairs of opposites, just like the pairs of opposites lasers, which set up the conditions for fusion and a oneness experience at the end of the Shakespearean play, which is really the alchemy of fusion of people as well as, and everyone realizes it's well known that the chief subject of the Shakespearean plays is actually alchemy, and not just the spiritual psychological fusion alchemy, but the actual physics, which we want to get to here. And the second thing, and last, I wanted to just do as part of this intro was, in the conversation with one wonderful Teresa Burns, who's with us, I believe, Teresa and Alan, welcome. Teresa is our historian expert and really presents, and Teresa and Ellen and Paul are friends, it's all fun. So Teresa is a real historian expert on this, the actual historical evidence that Shakespeare learned to write plays about alchemy by being with Dee and Kelly when they did the alchemy in Prague that produced the purest gold that ever been measured in history by the British Royal Society. And so Vincent's story about that was they had ground up what originally was the famous red powder philosopher's stone, which Paul is about to get here, that they ground up what was believed to have been the actual Kaaba stone, Lucifer's eye, the Kaaba stone of the Muslims, which is known to be meteoritic glass, which we believe had propagated through it a gold, vaporized gold or platinum group metals or palladium. And we know the palladium gold platinum group metals have a valence electron shell symmetry, dodeca, icosa, pure implosive, monoatomic, phase conjugate, like monoatomic carbon, etc. So, and we also know that that's how the Templars vaporized gold through the glass to make the famous deep red purple glass of the Templar stained glass window. Now, the story was that the Mad Caliph sold, in historically documented, at least half the volume of the Kaaba stone, which was ground up to make this red powder, which is what supposedly was placed inside about the size of a grain of rice with wax for a wetting agent, dumped in the red-hot molten mercury in a phonon geometry, which we now know, we think we know the frequency of, and the geometry of the bubbles of the vaporized gold in the foam of that glass when it crystallized, we believe we can now calculate. So the phonon geometry of the macro bubble is self-similar to the geometry of the atom and the nucleus. We know the nuclear geometry, the electron geometry. We know the phonon geometry. So we know so much more about the physics of what was the Philosopher's Stone, which was actually the self-similarity, harmonic inclusiveness between the atomic geometry, the molecular geometry, and the macromolecular geometry, radiating a capacitance, which is a very broad spectral phase conjugate dielectric, and thus implosive, and thus the Philosopher's Stone, which has lots of meaning psychologically. And now, I'm going to turn it over to Paul. I just think it's so much fun to think about the physics, non-destructive charge collapse, and the psychology, both in one context. And I'm delighted that Paul can have that conversation. And Paul has a lot more hands-on experience than me. So now, Paul, it's all yours.
All right. Well, thank you, Dan, for that wonderful introduction. That was excellent. And really, yeah, that's really what alchemy is all about, is putting, it's a very holistic system where you're putting, integrating everything, mind, body, spirit, and putting all your intention into doing the ultimate perfection, the ultimate transmutation. And as much as everybody thinks, oh, alchemy is about making gold and these kind of things, it's really about perfecting yourself. And by doing that, influencing the environment around you. And yeah, that's sort of the key of alchemy. So this slide is from a past presentation, and I really like to tie sacred geometry into the alchemical sense, because it's sort of a little niche of alchemy that's not really discussed much. So we'll get into a little bit about that today, but I wanted to do some more, show you some practical slides of some of the work we do here at Vitriol Labs. Basically, this talk will be about mostly about plant kingdom and its similarities in the mineral kingdom. And when you get into the mineral works, you're basically just following the same footsteps that you do in the plant kingdom. So everybody learns the starters in plant work, and therefore you don't really poison yourself or blow yourself up too easily, which is always a hazard once you get into the mineral kingdom. So what exactly is alchemy? Let's just define this term right off the bat, because you hear it in so many different aspects, the alchemy of business. I saw alchemy yoga the other day, and all these sexual alchemy, psychology of alchemy. And really, alchemy is a really broad term that really gets used quite a bit today. But let's try to narrow it down to its actual essence. And I think my favorite definition of alchemy is the art of transmutation through fire. And because all the alchemical processes, physically, spiritually, emotionally, they all go through that fire. And, you know, everybody's experienced that fire emotionally when you have done something where you may get embarrassed or whatever, and you flush and you feel that heat from inside. So your emotions, as Dan was saying, how Shakespeare used the emotional component to his plays, and actually phase conjugating the emotions to provide that really strong contrast to lead you through the alchemical process, is really a powerful thing. So when we're working in the laboratory, we're doing actual physical hands-on alchemy, but we're also really paying close attention to our inner selves and our inner work. And by paying close attention to your emotions is really the key that all the yogis and masters throughout history have learned to understand themselves. Like the ancient Greek saying, know thyself, that was really the key to the whole picture. And by understanding yourself, then you understand nature. And emulating nature is really what alchemy is all about. You're basically just observing nature and recreating the natural processes in the laboratory and within yourself to raise the products you're working on and your personal self to higher states of vibration, essentially. So
there was a nice saying, Paul, about the real alchemic fire is a flame that does not consume. You know, implosive cold fire, which is gets the metaphor that if you have intense emotion and yet it doesn't consume you, that's bliss. And
yeah, exactly. And that's the big part of it, is not to get caught up in your emotions. Like when people are out day to day and they're driving on the road and they experience that road rage. Well, if you catch that emotion before you physically respond to it, and you swerve or, you know, shake your fist at somebody in the air, then what you're doing is intercepting that response to the emotional behavior. And by doing that, that's how we refine and hone in our processes, and it improves your general state of being and your makes life much easier, really, when you go with the flow rather than trying to resist it or react against it. So that internal fire is what the alchemists called the secret fire, and there's several different stages of fire. And so you can look at a physical fire as being, you know, a flame, and interestingly enough, that flame is actually plasma. And if we have time towards the end here, we can talk a bit about plasma and especially cold plasma. So there's a contradiction in terms in that sense, because most people think of a plasma as hot, but it's really unique. So you can look at it as a phase conjugating aspect of plasma itself, and its cold state does a lot of really unique things compared to hot plasmas, which
implosion.
Yeah, exactly. So these are four of the original elements in an old alchemical woodcut. You have earth, water, air, and fire. And on top of the women there, you see the little flasks with the homunculus in there and the eagle and the bull. And so these all are symbolic of earth, air, water, and fire, which are basically the four original elements. And, you know, when I was in high school chemistry class, my chemistry teacher said, oh, yeah, well, chemistry kind of came from alchemy, but those alchemists, they were all kooks because they thought there was only four elements, and they thought they could turn lead into gold. And everybody knows there's more elements than that, and it's impossible to turn lead into gold. And I kind of took offense to that, because you really have to understand the philosophy of alchemy. So we look at it, you know, from three parts. There's the physical, hands-on, practical part, the philosophy, which is knowing the symbolism and the interwoven meanings, and the actual theory and the physical theory, which is really where science came from. Like all things kind of stem from alchemy, essentially. I picture alchemy as sort of the central tree of all things, and then biology, chemistry, physics are just branches off the tree of alchemy, because alchemy is sort of a universal principles that underlie all things. And that's essentially what the four elements were. Go ahead.
That ancient story about the chem in alchemy and chemistry, meaning, you know, Highwood Firestone, literally access to a black hole. So the pure principle of making implosive black hole, the chem in chemistry and alchemy, which is the pure principle of fusion and everything we're talking about.
Yes. And all the first stage in alchemy is death and blackness. So you have to go through the black hole to emerge on the other side. Essentially, that's the key. Yeah. And we do that through fire. So fire is this one on the right here. And so that triangle, if you look at those triangles again a bit closer, sorry, I'll go back, you can see that they interlock into each other, and they actually form the Star of David or a hexagram. And those symbols themselves are phase conjugation. So we have the earth and the air. You can picture them as phase conjugated, as well as water and fire. So we know they're fully
opposing vortex.
Yeah, and also vortex. So now you turn those triangles into 3D and to a cone shape, and you have spiraling vortexes that go up and down. And we'll talk a little bit about that later. So basically, we're going to look at the four elements, the three kingdoms, the vegetable kingdom, animal kingdom, and the mineral kingdom. And you sort of start out in alchemy works in the vegetable kingdom, as I was saying earlier, and you kind of get your feet wet and get some experience in the laboratory. And all this, as you work up into the animal kingdom and the mineral kingdom, the processes are identical to the vegetable kingdom. So if you want to learn how to make the philosopher's stone, you start in the vegetable kingdom making spagyrics, and we'll talk a bit about that in a second here too. And the other key principles to grok for understanding alchemy is this concept of sulfur, mercury, and salt. And these are called the three philosophic principles. And you can see in this chart here how it sort of represents the Trinity. And so in the Kabbalah, you have the tree of life, and you have the three supernals at the top, Keter, Chokmah, and Binah, and it's like the mother and the father, and then the spiritual sort of center between the two. So we see that Trinity repeated over and over in all these things. So what I always suggest students to do is to draw this chart out in a book, and then you can add to it all the time. Whenever you come up with a unique trinity, you say, well, which aspects are more sulfur-like, which are more mercury-like, and which are more salt-like. And basically, the sulfur principles are more the essence or the soul of the thing. And when we look in the plant kingdom, which we're going to do today, we'll look at the sulfur being the essential oils of the plant. And the mercury is basically fermented alcohol of the plant. It's considered the spirit. And that's why we call alcohol spirits. And a lot of names that we have in the English language came from alchemy. You'll run into them over and over. I'll point them out as we mention a few of them today. But you'll see that over and over. When you understand the lingo of alchemy, you start to understand the depth of language quite a bit deeper. And you can tie in a lot of other languages like Latin and Greek and stuff like that as well. And then our third principle is the salt principle, and it's the fixed principle or the actual body. So when we're looking at a plant, it's the actual body of the plant. If it's a mineral, it's the physical body of the mineral matrix, the crystalline structure. And so essentially, those three principles sort of apply universally. Now, the next stage in the line, you notice how, I guess I should have started this off with like the monad, because if you look at the Tetractys, and you can see that there's, well, we'll get to that after this slide, I think, but you can go the one, from the one, all things come and all things are going to return to, and they all move through the one. That one principle, you know, divides into two, and those two into three, and four, and so on. So you have the three duality, the sort of fixed and the volatile, and then you go into the three principles and then the four elements, and then the next number is seven. And here we have the seven planets, the seven original planets, which include the moon and sun. And how they relate to each of the metals. And interestingly enough, you know, we have a lot of hidden symbolism in our calendar and our clock, with the hours of the day and the days of the week. And the days of the week are actually all named after the original seven planets. So if you're into astrology, you can do a lot of these processes that if you're working on a particular plant or a metal, you can do it specifically to that time of the day or the day of the week. So, for instance, Sunday is related to gold and Monday related to silver. And the sun is related to the gold and as well as the moon. So we get our names like Sunday, Monday is Moon Day, Tuesday Mars, and so on. And it's interesting to note that the days of the week actually phase conjugate. So what you have in the middle of the week is Mercury, and Mercury is sort of the go-between who ties things together and would fly between the earth to the heavens and be the messenger of the gods. You always see him with the little wings on his feet, like my logo at the front. So Mercury is sort of the balancer, and that's what Mercury does. It's somewhat of an adaptogen, and it's able to move things quickly and work in between the realms. So here we can see what I'm talking about earlier with, we have this, the original one thing, or what we call in alchemy, the prima materia. Now the prima materia is the key thing that everybody is looking for to make the philosopher's stone, because they know they need to make their philosopher's stone out of this prima materia, but everybody argues about what the prima materia was, and, you know, we've been looking at, as Dan mentioned in the intro there, meteorite substances as the prime materia. And they can definitely be used in making the philosopher's stone. And the thing is, the alchemical understanding of what the prime materia is a mystery, because in reality, it's sort of all things. It's everything has the potential of becoming the philosopher's stone. It's just some things are a lot easier to do than others. So if you're starting with a feather, yes, you can start with a feather, but it's going to be a lot easier to start with something that's more evolved and closer to the stone in the chain, as in some minerals. So starting with lead or antimony or something like this. So that's why we see the mineral kingdoms come into play in this part. And then this monad sort of divides into this duality. And this duality is the fixed salts and the volatile salts, sometimes called nitre. So a fixed salt would be, you know, simple salts like sodium chloride, and nitre you would see like more volatile salts, something like potassium nitrate, and all the nitrates, that's where, you know, it's an Egyptian word from those white plains of salts that were fairly volatile that they went and collected in the desert and did a lot of alchemical work with. And then the next stage shows the relationship, how it divides again. And the fixed divides into the earth and the water, and the volatile into the air and the fire. And then the next stage shows how they correspond with the three principles that we talked about.
To mention, the nitrates were used for mummification capacitively.
Yeah, absolutely. The there was a lot of, you know, one of the stories that Dan tells all the time is how they ground up the mummies into the mummy powder, and because of the monatomics in there, and they definitely used the nitre from the soil and various other, a lot of essential oils. So the Egyptians were really adept at doing a lot of alchemical processes, and a lot of people believe that alchemy sort of stemmed out of ancient Egypt. So yeah, you guys talked last week a lot about John Dee, so I'm not going to get much into the story of that, but I just wanted to bring it up, and Teresa's excellent class there last week with John Dee. We'll tell a bit of that story, but I want to talk about a couple other alchemists, and one of them is a very well-known, you know, founder of modern science, Sir Isaac Newton, who a lot of people don't really know that he was actually, you know, a really adept alchemist. And when he passed away, his parents sort of were embarrassed in the whole family, so they buried a lot of his alchemical works, and they just actually started showing up in the last few years. And there's a group out there, and I think it's Indiana State University, who's publishing a lot of his papers, and the Chemical Heritage Foundation has actually recently translated a new one, and it's all about the philosophical mercury. And the philosophical mercury is similar to the prima materia in that nobody really knows what the philosophical mercury is, but the alchemists talked about it and said it could dissolve all things, and it was an essential ingredient in making your philosopher's stone. So we're really excited about that new paper coming out right now. And then another character that we'll get into a little bit more is Paracelsus. And Paracelsus was, you know, a real rebel. His whole name was Aurelius Philippiosus Paracelsus Bombastus von Hohenheim. And we get the word bombastic from him because, you know, he was very in your face, and he, when everybody else was teaching in Latin, he taught in common tongue in German, and he challenged most of the established academia and medical people at that time. And he was the first to create this spagyric process that we're going to talk about today. And he actually coined the word spagyric from Greek, which is two words, speo and agirio, which basically means I collect, I gather together, and then take apart and or extract. And what you're doing with the alchemical process in this case is working with plants. You separate them into their sulfur, salt, and mercury. So you're taking the spirit of the plant, the soul of the plant, and the physical body apart of the plant, and you're taking them apart and refining each one into its purest state. And then you recombine them back together, and that makes your holistic, elevated, more powerful medicine from plants. So we start off in the garden. This is one of my older gardens in the backyard, and we do a lot of wildcrafting, and we grow a lot of our own herbs. And you take your plants and you basically stick them into this first essential oil distillation process. So in this particular apparatus, I've got some goji berries in there. And even though gojis don't have a lot of volatile oils in them, I was doing this experiment to see how much there was and what their properties were. And they're very, very unique what came out of this distillation here. So this whole apparatus basically distills the essential oils off. And it does it through steam. And this is a steam distillation. And as the water and the oil condenses in those condensers at the top, it settles on the bottom and you get your layer of essential oils of the plant. So this here is basically the sulfur of the plant. And we tap that off and refine that to its purest state. And then all the body of the plant goes into basically a digester where it ferments. And so this is a carboy, and this would be just exactly the same process as making wine. You're just adding yeast into the mix, and the yeast is usually Saccharomyces cerevisiae, and what it does is it eats up all the sugars in there and it turns them into alcohol and carbon dioxide. And so you have a little relief valve on there, and in the end, you get a really nice herbal wine. And then after you've done that, you take all the plant matter and you burn it down to the ash. So you see fire in all these processes. In the first process where we're boiling water basically to make steam, that's the fire that's separating the essential oils. In the process with the fermentation, it's the yeast and the active life force of the yeast that's creating the alcohol, and that's extracting the spirit from the plants. And here we're extracting the body, or the core essence, the refined essence of the body, which are actually the minerals that make up the plant. So we do this through just burning, and this is just a bowl on a fire pit kind of thing, and I have rosemary in there. And you can't really do this in your backyard in the city. I used to have some pretty forgiving neighbors because huge clouds of smoke will come up and smoke everybody out, and they'll wonder what that funny smell is, because a lot of these herbs have various different smells and odors. And so in this process, you basically cook them down to a very white ash. And when you have the white ash, in this ash is contained all the mineral matrix that made up the body of that plant. So here we have our salts, and this is sort of the refining process. And as these salts get more and more refined, they go from the black stage, which the alchemists called the negredo stage, which was in that last slide, to the albedo stage, the white stage, which we're getting to here. And it takes days and days of burning. You'll burn down that first little bit in a few hours, but then we bring it into the laboratory after there's not much carbon monoxide coming off of it anymore, and we'll burn it in the lab for days. So this little crucible is actually a quartz crucible here, and it can withstand really high temperatures. I can heat this up to 1,000 degrees and pour cold water on it, and it won't break. It's very interesting because it literally boils the water and sublimates pretty well. It just flashes off into very, very high density kind of steam. And so that's one of the processes for getting your salts refined. And then we do a distillation. And so we take our wine from the fermenter, and we refine our spirits through distillation. And this process, again, emulates nature, in essence, because inside of your boiling flask, where you just start off with raw wine, the alcohol vapors boil at a lower temperature than water does, so therefore they rise up and they'll condense in the condenser and come down. So it's essentially the way the earth works, where water comes up off the oceans and evaporates into the atmosphere, forms the clouds, and you'll see the little clouds in here, and then they'll condense into rain and it'll come back down, and then you get it in your receiving flasks. So by doing this, you increase your alcohol content to very high, and you can do multiple distillations. So on the first distillation, I usually get about 60 to 70% alcohol. And then when you're done, you pour it back into the boiling pot and you distill it again. And we usually do that 7 times in alchemy. And that one of the code words in that, you'll hear this a lot in alchemy, is there's a lot of terms that are, alchemical code is letting the 7 eagles fly. That means you'll do 7 distillations of your product. And so part of the alchemical process is learning to understand the lingo, basically. And we get another word that comes from alchemy, actually, is the word gibberish, because a lot of people read alchemical texts from one of the most famous alchemists in the Middle East was Jabir, and he wrote so cryptically that everybody said, I can't understand a word. He's saying this is all gibberish. And so we get our word from that. And here you see one of the old alembics and distillation from the Middle East. So what happened with alchemy, a lot of people say when Egypt was on its decline, the alchemical knowledge moved into the whole Arabia and Middle East area, and so that's where we get the word alchemy from. The L is sort of the Arabic article word, really meaning the, and chem, as Dan said, the blackness, the black stone or the black sands or just the black hole void that everything has to pass through in order to be reborn again, because essentially an alchemical process is exactly that. It's this refining through fire and then the rebirth. And if you look at even the Bible, I used to study a lot of Hebrew and read the older versions of the Bible. When you start to understand the alchemical processes and you read the book of Genesis, for instance, you read it like alchemical text. It's got a whole new underlying meaning. When God moves over the face of the waters, and the waters were chaos and darkness, right? So that's your blackness and your chaos. And that's one of the things we call an alchemical menstruum that you would see in that fermentation thing is a chaos. And so it goes through that blackness stage where it putrefies and ferments. And then he said, let there be light. And there's 2 key points in that. And that is, the first one is the verbalization of the word, or we call the logos. And the logos is really the vibration, the vibrational power. And we've seen, I'm sure everybody's familiar with sonoluminescence, which utilizes phase conjugating principles, as well as 2 transducers. You basically strap onto the side of a flask when you calculate out the harmonic resonance of that flask, and you fill it up with water, and you put 2 waveforms in there that are out of phase. When those phases meet at the center, very similar to what the Therify is doing, they cancel each other out. And what happens when they cancel each other out at the center of that flask in sonoluminescence is a tiny bubble appears. And that's the light. And it automatically, spontaneously lights up, and the photon emission is incredible. And it's actually moving, this little bubble, at like Mach 7. inside the flask, and the photons are literally being generated from the water inside of there. And the temperature of that little bubble is also hotter than the surface of the sun. So what's going on here, right? We have just...
Photoluminescence stuff is very famous. Oh, we have somebody with a mic problem. 1 second. Yeah. But that photoluminescence got very famous, sonoluminescence, in the movie Chain Reaction, where it was his, I think it was violin that triggered the chain reaction. It was a sound. It was photon geometry, actually.
Yeah, and, but exactly.
Paul, just and a quickie here. Does the metaphor of the salt being the sort of inner mass mean that the sort of the solid mass component versus the mercury being the charge field, the more distributed charge field, as in the distributed charge field in the liquid? So you can think of the charge field versus the mass, or is that what that metaphor
was? Yeah, absolutely. So salt would be the mass, the field would be the spirit, and then the field has two components to it. Basically, it's like a magnetic and an electric field. So you can see those as the sulfur, as the magnetic, and the electrical component as the spirit. And so that's the charge field, and it's around all salts. When you put salt on your tongue, you feel that tingle, and that tingle is the charge that's coming off of the molecules. And that's really how we made the first batteries too. Volta created the voltaic pile, and he just simply took salts and saturated them in water in between cotton and a zinc and a copper plate, and voila, you have electricity. So what are you so doing?
You could think of this in terms of wavelength, and the salt, the mass, is the shorter wave, the atomic dimensions, whereas the charge field is the longer wave, sort of that?
Well, I guess you could say it's the salt that holds the geometry, and then the waveform is manifest from the geometry, and the waveform is the electricity coming from the geometry of the salts.
And well, in a sense, the mass, the atom, is a waveform too. It's just shorter, so it's a matter of scale in a way, but both are symmetry. But and then you can talk about the self-similarity, and that would lead you to implosion. So.
Exactly. And then you also have that phase conjugation in the ionic components of the salts as well. So you have these separating of charges that creates the positive and negative in the battery. And so that's how we're doing, taking it from the actual physical and turning it into something more etheric, as we're talking about these concepts of spirits and soul. And electricity can really be seen as that vital life force. And in my opinion, this entire phenomenon is purely electrical phenomenon, the whole universe. I'm sure some people are familiar with the Thunderbolts project.
Electric universe.
Yeah, the electric universe principle, which it basically says, and it's true, when you get into the core fundamentals of physics, chemistry, or biology, it all comes down to charge. And it's all about the charge. So this whole physical experience that we're having is an electrical phenomenon. And we have to sort of relook at how we take our physical sciences and we kind of classify and categorize everything. And what we've done, we said, oh, this is the electrical component and this is the magnetic component. And they're at 90 degrees in phase, so you're looking at current and voltage in 90 degrees phase angles and things like this. But what I'd like to do is extend that clock and say that electricity, magnetism, and light and gravity are all arms on the cross. They're all the same thing in different manifestations. And how those waveforms meet is where the interference patterns are that create this matter. And that's what it's all about. It's all about charge. Everybody's heard the atomic story, how there's, you know, if you have a grapefruit at one end of a football field and a pea at the other, well, that's basically a hydrogen atom. So you have your proton as your nucleus, and your electron is that pea at the other end of the football field, but you have this massive gap of space in between. So what keeps my hand from moving through the table when it hits it? It's not that it's matter that's holding the, that's pushing back on the resistance. It's actually the charge that's emanating from the matter, as we discussed with the salts. And that charge field has all the potential in the world. And that's the other thing where physics is lacking, is not understanding the field. And it's really all about the field, because it's all field effects and field phenomena. And when we're doing alchemical processes, we're meditating on all that. And the amount of insights that you'll gain from just doing these, they seem like very simple works, but you know, a lot of this stuff, I just had made these kind of realizations in the laboratory. And so there's a picture of my messy laboratory with a distillation apparatus here. This is the head of a 10-liter boiling flask is inside of this metal pot that has a sand bath bed around it. And it's distilling off the wine, which you can see the rectified spirits or the mercury on the other side here. So that's during one of the distillations. And in the end, we'll take those three components, the sulfur, salt, and the mercury, and basically once they're all refined, we combine them back together into the spagyric tincture. So
basically, Paul, when you remix that charged liquid back with the refined powder, you're sort of putting the long wave and trying to re-trigger order back in the short wave.
Exactly, and they mesh perfectly because they've been separated for so long. They have a really strong desire to go back into that unity. So yeah, it's kind of, you're doing the negative entropy within, as nature does. You know, everybody says, "Oh yeah, the whole universe is winding down." We had this argument the other day with some people. The standard model that they teach leaves nature out of the equation. And alchemy is really all about nature. So self-similarity and self-combining and reforming into these patterns is replication, is what nature is all about. That's why it's fractal in nature. And when you recombine those three components together, the marriage is amazing, and you get a really unique chemical reaction where everything kind of stirs around inside your flask.
Ooh.
And so I don't know if you can see the video very well, but here's just a basic tincture from some berries from I think this one here is a devil's club. It's sort of wild ginseng that we have growing here in where I live in Canada. And so this is a simple tincture. And basically, all you need to do is make this tincture is put vodka on top of a herb, and you filter it off after 3 or 4 weeks once it's taken on this color. That's why we call it a tincture. It comes from the Latin word tingo. And so this tincture is a very powerful medicine in itself. But when you add the essential oils and the salts of the plant together in there, then it makes that standard tincture like 10 times more powerful. So you have to take less, and it's much more effective. These are some of the
negentropic, more healing.
Yeah. And so these are some of the refined salts, and you can see at this stage they're very white. So they went from that black burning pot to this albedo stage, and they're very electric. If you put them on the tip of your tongue, it just, the charge goes right through your body, like zing, and they're highly charged. So again, when we're looking at monatomics and how, you know, the Ormus story and how plants absorb a lot of different monatomic elements, well, they're all in here. And it's one of the components that give this medicine very powerful property. So we recombine the essential oils and the salts into that tincture, basically. And then you end up with a spagyric tincture. And this is one of the products that we make. It's called Quantum Solutions, and they're spagyrically created herbal tinctures, and basically some of them take a long, long time, because you can see a lot of those processes take months, like the fermenting. And so first you go out into the field and you gather your herbs and do the oil distillations, and you do these distillations over and over again, and the calcification or calcining of the burning of the herbs that we saw in, with the salts, that takes days of burning. And so it's not really a great economic business model to, that's why you don't see them commonly, is because they take a lot of time and a lot of work to prepare. But they do make for very powerful medicines. And I teach classes on how to do this. And so a lot of people traditionally in alchemy were, you know, the alchemists would sell these to apothecaries that would sell them as healing things to various people. But there has been a bit of the purist concept of alchemists. They say, well, you're best to learn the process yourself and do it for yourself, because that's when you get the most learning and educational and healing properties from them, is when you actually make them yourself. So it's a lot of fun.
Did you want to tell any quick story about examples of people using them, or typical, you know, like what their application?
Yeah, like one of the ones that I have here, well, actually, this is a wild licorice, but a good application for them, like they're very effective. So a standard dose of just a regular tincture, you would take, you know, 14 to 20 drops three times a day, whereas a spagyric tincture, you just take two or three drops once a day, kind of thing. And one of my favorites for students is when they're learning, we use rosemary. Rosemary is really good for the memory and the digestive system. And so as part of the learning process while you're studying, you can just take a few drops of the rosemary tincture. And then as you're doing your studying, and then when you go into your final exam, you just shoot back like half a dropper of that rosemary tincture, and you get instant recall of everything you've been studying as you've been sort of programming your brain. So a lot of these things will cross the blood brain barrier instantly, and they trigger all kinds of things. And in rosemary's case, it's sort of synaptic responses to memory. And it's similar to, you know, when you smell a familiar smell that you knew as a child and you haven't smelt it for years, instantly you get that memory recall where you flash back to the church where they're burning the frankincense or whatever it is, right? It's because then the olfactory system is deeply connected to the reptilian brain and triggers a lot of the memory recall from things like that. So that's kind of how the rosemary works. And all the different plants in herbology have all been assigned to different planets. So when we look at a particular one, rosemary is related to the sun. So we do our process of rosemary on a Sunday. And so you can see how you're creating a fractal layer of intention in your processing. And that is really increasing the power of that medicine. So it's not just the crystalline matrix, charge matrix of the salts combined with the essential oils, with all their ketones and all the chemical phytochemistry of the herbal extracts that's doing the work. It's really a compounded process, and that's what makes it alchemical.
So making a spagyric tincture, you could say, in a way, is potentizing the natural charge symmetry of the plant and exponentiating its negentropy or something like that.
Yeah, absolutely. It's increasing, it's maximizing the negentropy all the way. And it's really interesting to see how they work, because a lot of times, like I put these in Myron glass, so this one's a little hard to see because it's pretty well opaque. It's a very dark violet color. And it only emits a very low wavelength of ultraviolet that goes into these solutions. And that ultraviolet is very, it's a very charging frequency for medicines. And that's why we use the Myron glass. And
well, what I've seen, We're doing a partnership with Myron Glass Company. We've actually studied the two frequencies of radiance to optimize the phase conjugate wavelengths optically of the colors of the Myron, which are actually implosive. And we believe we can improve that with what we're discussing about making the alchemic glass. So that metaphor goes a long way. Fun.
Exactly. Yeah. And, you know, Myron Glass is very popular these days because a lot of people understand that those principles. It was, you know, difficult when they started out in years ago when you tried to describe a lot of this stuff to people and nobody got it, you know, it kind of just went over their head. And I think it's part of the evolution of consciousness and the evolution of man, how we are living in such exciting times where all this knowledge and information base is just at our fingertips, right? In the alchemist day, if you wanted to know something, basically you had to know where that book was that contained the information and be in some monastery somewhere, and you'd have to travel through dangerous lands on your horse avoiding spears and arrows and things, and you'd get to the monastery and then you had to knock on the door and they'd let you tend the garden for a few weeks or months before they let you into the library, and then you could gain access to the information. Well, now we have Google. And anything you want to know, anything you is at your fingertips. Entire reported history of mankind is pretty well online now, and everybody's sharing information. So we live in this information age where everything is accessible. And as Isaac Newton said, you know, I stand on the shoulders of giants, and that's what he meant by that, was that the accumulated knowledge at that point is what makes the background of your capability of understanding these things. So it's part of the evolution of consciousness, and the internet's really accelerated that quite a bit.
And we're excited with Paul's expertise to evolve the bioactive glass commercially, because now we can optimize the actual color frequencies to phase conjugate, plus we can optimize the dielectric constant with trace minerals, plus we can optimize with the vaporized gold through with the philosopher's stone stuff. There's a lot of places to go now that we know the physics of bioactivity in glass.
Yeah. So one last thing on the spagyrics. So if I put that bottle in the sun, in the window, and I've done this in sort of an amber bottle where you can see into it a little bit more, you will see the crystalline matrix form, and it actually is a liquid crystal, and you'll see all the X and Y, Z axis of the crystalline structure form in there. And one day I had one sitting in the window, and I was like, wow, that's a really nice one, and I went to reach for it. And just before I actually touched the dropper bottle and pick it up, the crystal disappeared just from the charge that was on my hand and as I was going to pick it up. So it instantly went back into the liquid state. So they're very interesting, and a lot of strange anomalies happen with these things. And
well, like from sensitive crystallization processes in the blood, you know, where you have sensitive crystallization growth.
Yeah, absolutely. So if you think of what's happening in your body when you consume these highly potentized, highly energized, negentropic gathered concentrates, and you put all that intention into it, that goes into your body, and it's refining your body in that sense. So basically what we do is we do that for all seven planets in the plant kingdom, and then we have prepared our body physically, mentally, and spiritually through the processes, and by consuming these highly charged liquid crystals, now we're ready to move into the mineral works. So I just want to go into a little bit about a fellow who wrote a book called The Universal One, and his name was Walter Russell. And this is one of his periodic tables from The Universal One. And basically,
the Zoom command, Paul.
Okay, well, I'll start with this slide and we'll go back to the next one so you can understand this layout. So if we zoom in on here.
Yeah, that's fun.
Yeah. So he based this whole table, and you can see how it's basically sine waves. And all the nodes on the sine waves align with all these different elements. And he hinged...
The top is the conjugate point.
Exactly. And the whole thing hinges on this carbon. And he created these octaves. And when you... at this time, the periodic table was, very simple, the Mendel periodic table that we use today. And it didn't have a lot of the elements on there. And he predicted all these different elements and their isotopes through this model. And if you look at the next slide, you'll see that it's actually a three-dimensional spiral, because that sine wave is the same table, but now you're looking down on the sine wave, which is actually a spiral. And he placed all the noble gases across the center here on the spiral. So the amount of complexity of how all these elements fit together, and Walter's, this book reads literally like scripture, and he explains light, magnetism, gravity. And, when he wrote this book, he got hit by lightning and he went into a coma. He was just an artist. He wasn't an academic or anything like that. He went into a coma after being struck by lightning, and they didn't think they were going to get him back. And when he started to come around after a couple of days, he was just babbling all this stuff about the nature of the universe and how the elements worked and magnetism. And the doctors thought he was crazy. They thought he was insane. They were going to lock him up. And they said, well, maybe he'll get over it and we'll just let him be. And he ended up writing this book called The Universal One that these diagrams are from. And he sent it out to all the academic institutions and characters of the time, which would have been, at the beginning of the 19th century, or beginning of the 1900s, would have been Niels Bohr, Albert Einstein, Nikola Tesla. These guys all got a copy of the book, all the universities all over the world. And only one person wrote him back. And who was that? It was Nikola Tesla. And Tesla said to him, Walter, I think you should take that book and bury it in a sepulcher for 1,000 years, because humanity is not ready for this information yet.
But the metaphor today would be when we discovered that the symmetry of the hadrons of the nucleus are platonic, completing dodeca-icosa at the max, exactly the same way the SPDF subshells interdigitate and form the electron shells into dodeca-icosa, etc. So you have the inside-outside self-similarity. So now we kind of know where he was coming from, finally.
Yeah, exactly. And, Moon was very good on his geometric model of the atoms as well. And I think that primitive model that we have of the atom, where there are these little particles and they have the charge and the electron moves spinning around and that, it's we're starting to understand what quantum physicists were really saying for a long time, and that is that these particles, and the other ridiculous thing is we're looking for this God particle. We're splitting them into pieces and pieces, and what do we get? More pieces. Well, because everything in nature is fractal and recursive, it's going to go infinitely in either direction. So we can keep splitting things into smaller and smaller components, but all we find is smaller and smaller subatomic particles. And so sort of the same thing as the macrocosm. And this brings up an alchemical saying, too. The old axiom by Hermes Trismegistus is, as it is above, so it is below. And we see that that's basically saying everything is fractal and recursive, because it's an unfolding pattern that weaves itself infinitely in either direction.
And so now we know that the noble gases and the platinum group metals are precisely conjugators, because the nuclear array has completed tetracube dodecaicosa exactly similar to the self-similar completion of the SPDF subshell array, also tetracube dodecaicosa. And now we can actually model that self-similarity and extend it to the macromolecular and know the geometry of the noble gas, the gas in the bubble of the foam inside of the philosopher's stone, etc. So we can take it and actually scale it and understand exactly how to complete that collapse process from the micro to macro.
Yeah, absolutely. And this is where it comes into this idea of the zero point and vacuum energy. And where is that energy coming from that is creating all this matter? And Einstein's equation, saying it cannot be created or destroyed, and it's just a conversion of energy to matter. But I think we're quickly realizing, and we'll look at that in a little bit with when we get into our transmutation portion, is that this entire universe, the old model of the universe, all the elements in the universe was created in the Big Bang, and what is here, and everything's slowly winding down because of entropy, and then the whole thing will collapse on itself back again, is sort of been a bit of a misleader, because I'm a bit of a proponent of the whole expanding Earth theory. And matter is continuously growing, it's continuously transmutating, it's happening inside of you right now and on the ground you walk in continuously all the time. And we just never looked or had the understanding to look close enough at that, but we'll look at that here shortly.
And just to mention too that Mark is working in detail with Nassim's physics, showing that when the phase conjugate cascade goes down between the macro and micro nuclear level, it cascades precisely to the Planck sphere. That's where charge distribution is perfected, and that's where you can generate the negentropy, because you actually get into that perfect distribution point. So the physics is absolutely going to catch up with
this. I think we need to reform the periodic table and turn it into a three-dimensional table, similar to what Russell was doing. Because when we get into it's not just isotopes, but it's also this concept that's become very popular of the super deformed nuclei, or this idea of ormes or monatomic elements, and how these elements are changing their states, turning into superconductors, and they're not detectable by regular spectrometry and these kind of things. So we need to fold this table into at least a third dimension now.
The superconductive model from myself and Nassim both is the jitterbug, which is the collapse from Icosa to octa. And so that jitterbug is a three-dimensional collapse that follows the golden spiral path and thus conjugates, making perfect distribution called superconductivity. So the 3D model is exactly what's needed.
Yeah. And then, exactly. So these are sort of the old model of the electron, but it's going to give us one of our points here. So we talked at the beginning about earth, air, water, and fire, and everybody knows the basic archetypes of those things. So let's look at four elements: hydrogen, carbon, nitrogen, and oxygen. And you can see how the hydrogen relates to water, the carbon relates to earth, nitrogen relates to the air, and oxygen to fire. And interestingly enough, that these are the four elements on the periodic table that make up life. So all your amino acids and then your protein chains, DNA, and everything kind of starts out in this with these four atoms. And the whole idea of this primordial soup, when everybody says, looking back in time and how life appeared on this planet, and understanding how these four elements actually have a real affinity for each other to form these amino acid chains. And the first person to discover this was Dr. Miller and Urey. And these guys had a laboratory in the 50s. And they spent a great deal of time trying to recreate life forms from these four elements. So what they did is they set up this apparatus, and it's hermetically sealed. Again, another word that comes from alchemy, relating to Hermes Trismegistus, but basically meaning that it's completely sealed off. And the only elements inside this whole chamber, so they've got nitrogen in the air, they've got water and oxygen, or water making up the hydrogen and oxygen, and they have carbon, bits of carbon in here. Now this is going to lead into, we'll get into a little bit about carbon nanotubes and graphene and where that's taking us here in a bit. But this whole model is sealed, and they did everything they could to try and get these to chain together to make an amino acid. They they heated it, they cooled it, they froze it, they did all these things, and then one day they got this brilliant idea, hey, why don't we add electricity? Why don't we just charge it up and give it a little more power and see what happens? So that's what they did. They had these carbon rods in there, so they weren't changing any of the elements. And they took this 20,000 volt Tesla coil, basically. This is a handheld spark generator. And they put it on there, and they created lightning inside of this flask, and voila, amino acids appeared instantly in the solution. So what happened here? Basically, they were looking at the planet being this primordial soup where all the elements were sort of floating around in the ocean, and the missing component, they realized, was electricity. So all it would take would be a spark of lightning from the sky to hit the waters, and then boom, form these amino acid chains. And you have life. So there's been modern reproductions of this experiment where they're actually using lasers now and sort of a phonon shockwave inside this apparatus. And they did a lot of work in Prague on this. And they found they were doing the time that it takes from that pressure wave of the laser moving into the apparatus was like nanoseconds, where those amino acids were riding the shockwave, and all those elements, sorry, were riding the shockwave and then just forming into the geometry of these amino acids. So it's literally instantaneous. All you have to do is have those four basic elements and add energy to them, and they naturally combine into these things.
And you could optimize that spark to make it more phase conjugate. And interestingly, Tesla's lots of his discoveries, including reversible nuclear, started with his carbon arc.
Absolutely. Yeah. And it's really the principles behind the Therapy as well. It's like it's adding that energy. You know, I like to, one of the names I like to call the Therapy is a human battery charger. Because people talk a lot about, well, I feel drained or I don't have enough energy. It's really the human body is all about, it's an energy creating machine and runs on various different things from the air, the sunlight, the water, and supposedly the food that we put into it. And so that vitality is really, an electrical phenomenon. And that's just one of the many aspects of the Therapy and how it's working.
And so life is that charge implosion, right?
Exactly. So you're creating this implosion, and that's essentially what's happening in there. Because anytime you add electricity to water, don't believe the old axiom where they say, well, water and electricity don't mix. Because a lot of magic happens when you add energy into water in electrical form or song form, like we saw with the sonoluminescence. Then you have electrolysis. If you put a DC current into water, well, it splits apart the hydrogen and oxygen and produces this highly implosive Brown's gas. The modern term for it is HHO. That if you Google that, you'll see thousands of videos out there now where people are doing all kinds of stuff with that gas. And that gas has very unique properties. It's not just like hydrogen and oxygen. I like to look at it as more of a gaseous crystal.
And we were the ones to prove that hydrogen was fractal.
Yeah, absolutely. And because it's fractal is what allows it to be able to do some of the amazing things that it does.
Magic.
When you light it on fire, it's actually a cold plasma. It's only about 125 degrees. You can literally put your hand through this flame and it doesn't burn you, as long as you move fairly quickly. But then you'll touch it on a piece of tungsten and, at 6,000 degrees, it basically sublimates the tungsten. You're like, what's going on there? And it's very specific to whatever you touch it to. You hit it to metal, it'll hit the melting temperature of that particular metal, and some metals behave in very strange ways, like zinc, for instance. You hit that flame on the zinc, and it disappears before your very eyes. It's very interesting.
That's why they said when the rapture comes, it will melt the metal, but to you, it won't burn.
That's right.
It's a cold flame.
Yeah, there's cold plasma. That's one of the properties of it. In fact, it's very healing, too. They've made surgical torches where you can literally weld your skin together with the gas. And we use it quite a bit for all kinds of different things. I put it on, people have come with ringworm rashes, and we wrap their hand in sort of a sealed chamber and introduce the gas around there, and then these things are gone. And these are parasites, and it just kills them off, restores, balances the charge field within the body. So it's not only does
Brown's gas or magna gas, everybody has a name for it, but it's basically implosive cold fire from hydrogen.
Yeah. Well, the funny thing is, the very first documentation of that process was in like 1800. And Faraday wrote two laws on electrolysis and the principles behind it being a current phenomenon rather than a voltage phenomenon. And over, like we've discovered so many compounds and elements for it. It's been a basis of science in the early days. We did a lot of things with it. But then it fell out of reputation and understanding. And that standard Hofmann apparatus where they show you in high school and university where you have an anode on one side and an electrode on the other, and they're bubbling off the hydrogen and the oxygen, and they say, well, it's so inefficient that you couldn't possibly be good for anything, and it's energy intensive. But that system is archaic. That was like from the 1800s. Nowadays, what we're doing is we're taking 3/16 stainless steel plates, and we're putting them 1 millimeter apart. We're pulsing them with various different frequencies to match these resonances of your molecules and electrolytes in there, and they've gotten a lot more efficient. And what you can do with the gas is truly amazing. So just these simple guys that are trying to get better gas mileage in their car, yeah, sure, that works, because the gas is acting more like a catalyst, and you're burning more of the fuel in your engine than you are in your catalytic converter, as you normally would do. So that's one of the unique properties of that gas, for sure.
And the very famous Canisius experiments, where you see the cold water is burning with a blue flame, and all he's done is zap it with a longitudinal RF component, and we know the RF frequency he used was phase conjugate by my equation. So actually the cold flame from hydrogen triggered with the RF, it confirms the physics. We have a project on that.
Yeah, absolutely. So I think there's a whole area of discovery that we're going to find out in the future about that. And so then I threw in a few slides for fun, where I've been working with a lot of these Ormus type materials, and these are the salts, essentially. So these are concentrated salts from seawater, and they have a life form, a consciousness, and a mind of their own. And when you the alchemists, there's this big argument about consciousness we'll talk about for a bit here. The standard model in academia is like they're arguing whether dogs are conscious or what consciousness is and all this. And the alchemists have been saying for millennia is that all things are conscious and contain consciousness. And we definitely see this in all the different principles of the sulfur, salt, and mercury, but you really see it animated in the salts because it's what makes up the body. And so I was doing this experiment, and this shows that these salts can multiply. They have consciousness in knowing that they really want to get out of the container. When they're this refined, these monatomics are really trying to go to travel and to turn into other states, because they're kind of like a seed at this point, and they're capable of mutating into various different metals. And so that whole idea of the platinum metal group and all the monatomics fitting in with that platinum metal group. It's actually most of the periodic table. When you look at the whole periodic table, most of the elements in the periodic table are actually metals, and they're all capable of going into this super deformed nuclei state. So here I set these guys up, and I sort of labeled them and put the date on there and stuff, and I left that bowl on the bench, and I came back a few days later, and it was just in the bottom of this dish. It started growing up the sides, and I thought, oh, wow, that's interesting. They're growing, and they're growing right over the edge of the bowl. And within a few days, they had multiplied. And where this stuff's coming from is a really good question, you know? Like, is it coming out of the air? Is it manifesting spontaneously in this bowl? Well, it grew right up over the edge and across the table. It's consumed the label that I had put on there, and it kept on growing. I had to stop it. I had to scrape them up, get them back in there, and put a lid on it.
sort of like ice nine.
Yeah, exactly. So you see a lot of really unusual phenomena like this when you work with alchemy in the laboratory. This is some of the monatomics inside ice. This whole thing is a glass here. It's not a good picture, but it was basically frozen water. And they, because they levitate, they'll not only just move over the edges of things and crawl around, they'll actually levitate right out of your vessels, and a lot of them will move upwards. So you can see these hair-like crystal growths grow through the lid, even really high-density Nalgene plastics that are designed to keep, you know, nitric acid within these vessels. Well, these salts will just dissolve and move right through them. And here it's levitating as it freezes out into this spoon-shaped ice formation. So I just put this stuff in the freezer overnight, and this is what I found in the morning, and it was literally growing right out of the ice it looked like a spoon was the shape of this thing.
Like a spirit emerging.
Yeah, exactly. So that's the living part of it and the consciousness. And then, so here's just a kind of a funny one. These were some salts that I had sitting in a bowl, and I had left the stir stick in there. It's a glass stir rod. But when I came back in the morning, they formed, do you remember the image of the salt was a circle with a line through it? So they actually drew their own symbol inside of the salt solution on the bench. Uh-huh. So you run into a lot of really neat coincidences with alchemy working in the lab. This one I like is sort of a fractal pattern of a cloud formation. So remember I said how the salts were very electric, and they form the principle of how water and salts have this real affinity, and they work together very closely to form clouds and lightning and these kind of things. So here is a cloudy sky with lightning bolts coming down over the ocean here. So you really see the as it is above, so it is below real life in the laboratory.
Yeah, we call it precipitation in physics and precipitation in water. It's
Yeah, so this would be a volatilization, because the salts sort of volatilized, and the more volatile salts are moving up towards the top, and then the energy is precipitating out, because there's a charge balance between the two. So it's that phase conjugate relationship that we looked at with the four elements. So we want to talk a bit about the Philosopher's Stone and this idea of transmutation, because the Philosopher's Stone is basically has been reported to do two things. And one is to completely restore order in the body and bring the body into perfect health. And secondly, it will transmute lesser metals into higher metals. And so that idea of noble metals like gold is called noble because it doesn't corrode. Nothing can act on it. And the alchemists saw corrosion as sort of a disease of the metal. So rust would be an inherent disease that iron gets. And tarnishing on the silver would be a disease of the silver. But all these lesser metals, like lead, they're all evolving, and they all want to become gold eventually one day. So it's an evolutionary process, and we call that process transmutation. Anytime one element can be changed into another element. And in nuclear physics, you know, they see it all the time in fission reactors. And, you know, their prime objective in a lot of these nuclear power plants is not to make power, because it's very expensive way to make electricity. But they're actually refining these munitions grade elements for making nuclear bombs, basically. And but, you know, they deny the science of this low energy transmutation, or LENR, you'll see low energy nuclear reaction or nuclear change. This idea that this transmutation can be done spontaneously at low energy levels. When I, as I said earlier, in fact, it's happening all around you all the time, including within you. And this is one of the first modern people to write about this, Professor Caravan in France, talked about these biological transmutations, and he documented them quite well in several papers and experiments, where he deprived chickens of calcium, so, and measured the calcium content in their eggshells, but he fed them only silica, and he knew they were breathing oxygen. So he was saying that, what, you know, they weren't losing bone mass. Where was all this calcium coming from? Because they didn't have the raw elements as inputs into the chickens, because he kept them in a controlled environment. Well, basically what he was saying was, when you add the nuclear weight, atomic weight of the atoms of oxygen and silica, you get calcium. And so they were doing this biological transmutation within their body to form these new elements. And this was another experiment he did in plant material, where they measured the calcium and the potassium inside of a seed. And so they knew the weight, the quantitative analysis they did on the seed, and then they germinated it. And what was interestingly enough is, as it germinated, the calcium quantities went up, and the potassium quantities went down. And so he was showing these, how these elements are transmuting into each other, and gave some simple formulas for how that process was working. And this is some of them there. So basically, you have a sodium atom with 23 protons in it, and if you add a single proton that would just come from hydrogen, then you could turn it into magnesium. Or if you had magnesium with atomic weight 25 and lithium of 6, you could get plutonium and things like this. So he had a whole series of these reactions based on atomic weights, and it was really one of our first modern people who wrote about this, and he did a lot of groundbreaking work. Now, recently, the Russians have disclosed that they have been doing these biological transmutations for 30 years, and they, not only are they taking nuclear waste and doing a biological transmutation and remediation of this waste, they're turning basically the most toxic substances known to man that have been left over from these chemical nuclear reactors for making bombs and electricity. And this toxic substance, which is supposedly, you know, has half-lives of hundreds of thousands of years, they're putting it in with simple bacteria. And I mean, one of the most common bacteria that are all around you, it's in your front yard. And these things are eating it up and transmuting it into gold, titanium, platinum, silver. And now they've scaled this up to a commercial scale. And I really like this one professor, Stosky, who's been doing this work for a long time. I mean, this paper here, you can Google it and you can download the paper. He wrote in 2011, and in there he's, you know, they've been working on this for 20 years at that point. So, you know, in the early 90s, they started experimenting with this. And they now have a commercial viable method of using biological transmutations to convert nuclear waste into real metals that we'll be able to do amazing things with. And I foresee a day in a not too distant future where we'll be building bridges out of titanium with gold trim, and we'll use, you know, simple technologies such as this. And I mean, it's not a difficult process. They're literally taking radioactive isotopes, dumping them in hot water with these bacteria and keeping them in a sustained controlled environment. And they're eating up. And you can do simple experiments like this at home. If you take a silver coin and you put it in with the, remember the Saccharomyces cerevisiae was the yeast that we were using in the fermentation process. You put that in the water with a little bit of sugar to get them going, and when they run out of sugar, they kind of get hungry and they'll start to eat the silver, and they'll literally poop out gold, and they'll leave a gold layer on the coin, like it's like a you know, micron thick nano layer of gold coating on there, but it's a very simple biological transmutation. And somebody just mentioned Paul Stamets and the whole mycology thing. Well, that's another thing that we've been talking about recently, is that we realize that the mushrooms are doing a lot of the remediation of these nuclear wastes. And exactly how are they doing this? Well, it's through this biological transmutation. It's not a coincidence that when they analyze mushrooms with something like a XRF, X-ray fluorescence, they see metals inside of there. Well, it's because the mycelium network in the mushrooms are pulling the metals out of the ground, and they're doing the biological transmutations of them, and they're doing that with nuclear waste as well. In fact, when they went into the reactor in Fukushima with some robots recently, they discovered that there was this glowing green slime all over the walls. And this slime is literally eating up the radioactive isotopes and transmutating them. So, you know, nature has a way of taking care of itself. And it's very interesting to see that, you know, a lot of people talk about the environment and the damage we've done and this whole global warming issue and all these things. And literally, I see just around the corner with the technology that we have now and various different garages around the world. And I say garages because I think this whole new maker movement and people working on their own projects, they got enough information on the internet now. It's all out there. We can educate ourselves. We can get a PhD degree at home and understand a lot of these things and work on them ourselves. And so that's where the new science is going to come from. It's not going to come from the old paradigm where there's corporate structures that have teams of thousands of engineers in the building, because we know that model doesn't work. That's why they came up with Skunkworks, right? They had, you know, select 13 brains and put them in a nice environment and let them do their thing. It's much more productive than having teams of engineers try and figure out a project. Just look at nuclear fusion. They've spent billions and billions of dollars on these fusion projects. And, you know, here's some, you know, the Russians have been really good at this over the years, but it's happening. What's really ironic is that these processes are happening right inside our very bodies all the time. So it's kind of fun. That's a picture of Professor Vistotsky and me, and this other fellow, I forget his name, I think he was with Mitsubishi. This was at one of the cold fusion conferences at MIT, and it's really interesting that when these guys all get together, like this is what was happening at MIT, and I got to credit Peter Hegelstein, and not MIT as an institution, because what MIT did when these guys wanted to put on this modern day sort of cold fusion conference, because after Pons and Fleischmann fiasco and it got discredited by the media, and then everybody laughed and said, oh yeah, what a bunch of dumb guys, they didn't know what they're talking about. People have been working on this stuff ever since then, and they've had progress. And I mean, those guys that were there were the U.S. Navy, Mitsubishi, the Russian folks, all kinds of people all over the world telling how they're doing all these transmutations in the library. They were getting COPs of 5 to 50, so they're getting tons of energy out of their reactions. And on and on and on. And so what MIT did, they said to, you're not allowed to advertise on campus. And most of the professors said, if you guys end up going to that conference, you know, you're not going to end up working anywhere in the field. And they've continuously been pushing this science away from us understanding it. But that's part of the old paradigm. And fortunately now, we are on the cusp of some massive breakthroughs in energy, in health, technology, and all these things. So that's kind of where I focus my work on. This was a slide about basically electromagnetic spectrum, just to give you an idea of where we are. Like, this is our visual spectrum, this little sliver here, and then the colors that we see. Just because, you know, this is what our perception is, and our visual perception. And the old model of science says, well, if I can't perceive it, I can't measure it, then it doesn't exist. So now we know that this electromagnetic spectrum, you know, is practically infinite in either direction. And now that we can get over that old concept of just, you know, I won't believe in it until I see it. Now we can expand our consciousness and open up to some of these new ideas. And it's all about how these waveforms and fields fit together, as Dan's been teaching for who knows how many years, and all the geometry and all these principles behind all things. And that's really where I think it's part of the evolution of consciousness and our understanding and our ability to be able to manipulate this matter, and to understand that we all come from this one thing, and we are really sort of a divine manifestation of this life force. We're all one, and it's going to be a really interesting next few years to see what's going to come down the pipe here, because I think we're really accelerating towards this mysterious attractor, as Terence McKenna called it. But it's an exciting time to be alive, so... I'm going to wrap it up there for our little talk on alchemy, and if anybody has any questions, we'll be happy to answer. And
the two halves of the brain there are phase conjugating, just like the two opposite tubes of Therify.
Yes. And coming up, we're going to do, is it Therify talk that we're going to do together in the well?
2 weeks from today, Paul and I will teach about the Therify. Right here, please, yes.
Now we got some exciting developments to talk about coming up in a couple of weeks, too.
In terms of living plasma, self-aware, coming alive, and where you showed the crystalline material from the alchemy seeming to become self-aware, coming alive, negentropic. It was so rich, Paul, that you had those photos. It was great, really.
Yeah, we certainly have a lot of fun in the laboratory here.
And I did put the link in the window here about our friend Cedric Manu, who spent many years assembling the papers on microzymes, which is basically living bioplasma, measurably reducing radioactive material there. Beautiful paper on microzymes reducing radioactivity, which is bioplasma used to reduce radioactivity there. fractalfield.com/centripetal forces.
Yeah. So Cedric, well, another great. Another thing I didn't mention was we can utilize the energy from those transmutation processes as well. So there's really a boatload of energy that can be captured in the downgrading of those highly radioactive materials into stable elements. You can actually tap that energy and make some really good power generation. So even though they used all that energy to make this toxic waste, you can pull that energy back out of it now, which is kind of cool to to actually power things. So all those caches of nuclear waste that we're sitting on is really a gold mine in disguise, quite literally gold, and energetically, we could make a whole lot of power from that. There was one fellow named Paul Brown who started publishing papers on that, and unfortunately it was back in the times where the old paradigm did a lot of things like threaten his family and ended up dying in a mysterious death, but there's a whole new story.
It was a thorium nuclear battery and low-level radioactive triggered massive electron cascades, which actually became an incredible over-unity nuclear battery, exactly. Paul, do you see Gary Clark's question?
Yeah, let's get to some of these questions.
Gary Clark,
yeah. So the difference between the relative efficacy between the spagyric tinctures, the name spagyric, and regular tinctures. Well, the regular tinctures, you're leaving out the salts, and you're just using the mercury of the plant to basically, as a solvent, between the alcohol and the water, to dissolve some of the phytochemistry. So there's millions of compounds in a plant. They're very complex. They're little chemical manufacturing machines is what they are, and so we get that word phyto from the plant, the chemistry, and those are the compounds that modern pharmaceuticals take and isolate and then turn it into a medicine. Well, this idea of spagyria is more a holistic approach, because the concept is that when you have a plant, you're utilizing these phytochemicals as an army now, rather than a single isolated concentrated compound, which has side effects, because this army of all the other phytochemicals basically is doing the work and balancing the side effects of any isolated compound. So in a spagyric, what you've done is you've ramped up the energetic properties by including the mineral matrix within the spagyric, where all that mineral matrix would normally just get thrown away when you make a standard spagyric. So it's one of the main life force powers of the plant is in the salts, and that's why we add them back in.
And in frequency terms, okay, that might mean the higher frequency coherence component at the nuclear and atomic level is then more embedded in the lower frequency mechanism of the field effect of the liquid, perhaps, or something like that.
Yeah. And so the next comment about the bioluminescent bacteria, and that's part of the energy. That's the photonic emission, and we'll get into that in the Therify talk, but that's another property of biological life, is this capability of absorbing and re-emitting these photons right from the DNA level, and that's why they glow.
Great, Paul. Paul, there was a question about risks of heavy metals in this kind of work from Jilsa.
Okay. So this heavy metal risk. Oh, okay. Yeah, absolutely. Now, I've worked with a lot of these really toxic metals, including, cyanide, arsenic, antimony, lead, quite a bit in the laboratory. And that's one of the reasons why we start off with spagyrics, is because spagyrics are chelators. They're natural chelators. This charge balancing system that we talked about in the ionic transfer of the salts of the plant will go through, and they'll pull these heavy metals out of your body. And I think they'll actually help you with the transmutation as well, but we'll be in a deeper subject. So you can easily poison yourself. If that's why you don't jump right into the metal work. You start with the plant work because you're preparing your body as a vessel that can withstand this higher energy. Because if you think that the spagyrics are highly ramped up, once you get into the mineral kingdom and you start taking things like oil of gold, here's a little vial here that we recently made. This stuff is so powerful that, one drop of this does a lot of amazing effects, and including a psychological aspect to it. And so you hear these stories about people that get into the monatomics and they start taking these ormus materials and they go insane. Well, the reason is because they didn't do the groundwork in the plant kingdom. Their bodies weren't prepared for it. They weren't mentally prepared for it. And I've personally seen it with several of these individuals who end up poisoning themselves, and that metal poisoning literally makes you crazy, like the Mad Hatter. That's why the Mad Hatter was mad, is because he inhaled mercury vapor as he was steaming the brims of the hats, as they used to do, and everybody who was a hatter in the old days was literally off the wall because of the mercury poisoning.
There was a thought here about, well, first there was a question about the alchemic aspect of the therified plasma, and I think we may get more into that in 2 weeks when we do that, as you wish, Paul. But also then perhaps, does the metaphor of the cold fusion as non-destructive charge collapse triggered by phase conjugation, is that a useful metaphor here? Non-destructive charge collapse, like K-shell collapse and that kind of thing.
Yeah, absolutely, because that's the key to making the stone. Is this non-destructive collapse. And I should mention that briefly. So remember how I said at the beginning that following the steps that we use in the plant kingdom, we can make the philosopher's stone in the mineral kingdom. Well, let me give you the basic recipe for making the philosopher's stone, but I'm going to do it in the plant kingdom. So all you have to do is apply this to the mineral kingdom. Once you get there, and voila, you're going to make the philosopher's stone. Well, what do you need to make that? You need the salts and the sulfur, the essential oil of the plant, and the spirit of the plant, the mercury. And what the key is in the stone is because one of the words that we have in alchemy is elixir. And elixir, everybody generically terms it, oh yeah, it's a tincture or whatever, it's a smoothie, they call it elixirs nowadays. It's not really, the true definition comes from Arabic, and el again is the Arabic word for the, it's the article word, and elixir what meant ash, so the from the ash. And so this here white powder from the concentrated salts of the plant is what you use for your basis of your stone. Then to simply make a plant stone, which has incredibly healing properties unto itself, you would just take a good amount of this salt. Now realize that this here vial is goji berries. This was a whole truckload of goji berries. There was a guy in my neighborhood who was cutting down all these goji berry bushes in his backyard. And I said, hey, I'll take those. And so I took a whole pickup truck of goji berries and burnt them down into this ash. So you need a lot of plant material. Then you simply take your sulfur, which is your essential oil, and your mercury, which is your distilled alcohol, and you put this salt inside the philosophical vessel. And that would be an egg shape. So you have a nice, good phi ratio egg-shaped vessel, and you keep it at a very constant temperature, and you slowly drip the mercury and the sulfur onto your salts, and you'll see they'll start to breathe. They animate, just like in the bowls that I showed, and they'll come alive, and it'll start to do all kinds of different things. It'll go through different color transitions. We call it the peacock's tail, where it'll go through all the colors of the rainbow, and it'll eventually coagulate, if you do everything just right, into a hard stone, and that's a plant stone of that particular plant that you use. So if I did it with this, it would be a goji plant stone. And what you can do with this plant stone is, instead of making a tincture, you simply put the plant inside some herbs, the same herbs, so you put goji berries in the water, and you soak the plant stone, you dip your plant stone into it, and it'll immediately extract all the vital components of the goji berries into the water. You pull out your plant stone, dry it off, put it in your pocket, and then you can drink this really powerful extract that you've instantly made with your plant stone. So that's how you can make a stone in the plant kingdom. And you can also chip it off and take very, very small quantities the way you would the philosopher's stone as well. I mean, you don't want to consume the philosopher's stone directly, but we can talk about that later.
You're triggering the negentropic effect at a more and more refined level. The pine cones are kissing more and more accurately. Yeah. Jill asked Paul, does this explain why the Anu cultures got addicted to gold dust powder? They didn't do the spirogyric work. Do you see the last question from Joseph?
Yeah, well, I think that they were at the level where they probably didn't do this spagyric work, and that could have, you know, been part of it, as well as when you get into that level of power, then you become addicted to it, you know, as Dan, you've said so many times. So that spagyric work is also the feminine side, right? So you have the feminine and the masculine and the mineral side, and alchemy is all about the balance. And as soon as you take one thing out of balance in anything in life, we see it over and over in alchemy, things go wrong. So you are always having to balance the feminine and the masculine aspects of it. And that just went to two masculine aside. And then they, you know, became the power hungry rulers of the universe that they are, keeping slaves from mining the gold powder for them. That's just one aspect. And that's part of the, you know, patriarchal system that we've been in this cycle. And everything cycles, you know, more patriarchal than more matriarchal through time. And, you know, it was part of the old cycle. And
in that sense, too, they say that Thoth said that addiction to gold powder resulted in shortened attention span, fractionating the attention, and that actually if you did the long wave work, which is kind of like a plant work of the feminine, embedding in the longer wave, then you get that context, and that way keeps it centered.
Right. Yeah, and then embedding in that longer wave, if you think about it, you were encompassing more. So it's more in an enlightened state than it is in these short, quick vibrations. When you look at matter and you go up in the periodic table and this whole concept of as these isotopes become radioactive because their instability, those are very short wavelengths of gamma energy. Is like one of the highest forms of wavelengths that we know about. So.
Did you see Joseph's question there about if you can transmute gold, why mine it?
Well, this is exactly it. And I think this is where we're heading in the future. And for me, it's a bit of a flaw in the understanding, or maybe they just never got there. It's like, well, why did these guys mine gold in the first place? Because weren't they capable of doing transmutations of, you know, couldn't they just mine a meteorite for whatever it had on it, iron and stuff, and just try and transmutate it? So that's one of the questions I always had, too.
Well, actually, you know, Vincent said he was emphatic that the Egyptians made most of their gold by transmuting. But and Keshi and others have said, you know, the early Draco Anunnaki, no, they weren't able to transmute it, in fact, but the later could. So, you know, there's interesting stories about that.
Well, it's part of the spiritual evolution of the being, right? A lot of this has to do with the operator. And if you're just not capable of generating that field, I don't know how many people have tried. When you are trying to create the Philosopher's Stone for nefarious purposes, let's say, like you just want to make gold or you just want to take over the universe or whatever, it isn't going to happen. So that's a good point. Yeah, you're right there. So it's probably part of the field. Like I said, it's all field effect. And if your consciousness is not compatible with that field, then it's not going to allow you to do it.
I like Joseph's question here about Ormus in the morning dew. My initials are D-E-W, you know. So they collected the dew, supposedly.
Yeah. And there's a good book out there called the Mutus Liber, which means silent book. And so a lot of alchemical symbolism, like some of the drawings we showed earlier, are all explained within a drawing. And so that book is particularly about a male and female relationship, the alchemist and his wife, the alchemist, and how they work together, going out spreading sheets, and they would rub like big canvas sheets and pull it along the grass to collect the dew, then wring out that dew, because that is filled with this. Remember we looked at the volatile components of the salts and the nitres. Those really volatile salts or what's really floating around in the atmosphere gets collected and condensed in the dew. So again, it comes down to these warmest type elements and the monatomics, if you want to call them that. are highly concentrated in that dew, and we use that a lot in alchemy. So ideally, the best water you can collect is rainwater or dew, and it's very hard to collect that because you got to go out and get all these little droplets of dew. Second best is rainwater because it's highly charged from the atmosphere and contains all these elements, and you can do just a lot of really neat works with just dew or rainwater alone.
And the astrological alignment will have a lot of effect on the charge of the dew.
Absolutely. Yeah. When time of the day and the day you collect it on.
Yeah. There's a lovely question from Alan Moore. Folks, Alan Moore is leading our next week conference on using these plasma vectors in the Ophanim Enochian to invoke this Ophanim Enochian to call the angels as large-scale plasma bodies. And then in 2 weeks, Paul and I come back and teach about the Theraphy. So Alan is meantime asking this interesting, making this interesting comment about how Vincent talked about Ophanic, this calling the long wave with a hypercubic symbol index set of the Ophanic Enochian alphabet from John Dee. He talks about how this could magnify intent, sort of like the Theraphy, that, you know, very long wave intentions can actually call plasma beings of intelligences of stellar scale. And this is called galactic alchemy or Ophanic. Interesting, Alan.
Yeah, well, you look at some of the old axioms, like every man and woman is a star, and the concept that the Egyptians had where upon their death, they were preparing their bodies to occupy larger vessels at this point. So you're going from human to being a planet or a star or a sun. And this is part of your evolution. We know that, you know, Gaia and the idea of this planetary consciousness, everybody who's been part of the philosophical kind of concept that is a living conscious being, we're really just like a cell on this thing. It, the alchemical thing is we're all one and the whole universe is one. So why not just be part of the other components of the one?
Documented symmetry of the heart of the sun and the heart of the human and the heart of the hydrogen called Anu, seven spins, five spins, is actually, of course, cube inside pentodeca, which actually is the exact origin of Ophanim Enochian. So preparing your aura to embed in something bigger, fractally, the heart of a star, is actually growing up. And that's what was meant, you know, sun god is what Anu means. And actually, this is kindergarten preparing us to become stars in that sense.
Yeah. So somebody was asking about spagyric tinctures that are for sale online. Yeah, there's a few people out there. It's becoming more popular. One of my good friends, Saja Popham, has a school and a whole line of tinctures that he makes, Organic Unity, I think it's called. And there's a number of ones out there. Most people I've met who make them have pretty good lines and pretty good integrity. And I always wanted to put mine out there, but they're just, I make them, I have them here, and some people that know about them come by and get them, but it's not, unfortunately not my main focus right now. But if you're interested, you could email me and I could send you a list of some of the things that I currently have. And I could definitely send you some links of some really good suppliers out there. Yeah, like somebody just put the link there. And if you look at some of Saja's videos, he's got some excellent YouTubes on alchemy and the spagyric process if you want to dig really deep into it too.
The question here about using moldavite to make the stone. Remember the story from Vincent was they ground up the Kaaba stone of the Muslims, but then when they ran out of that, they realized that the moldavite, which was a meteoritic residue, which why Prague was a rose shape in the caldera, the moldavite in the streets of Prague became the philosopher's stone, the next one for Dee and Kelly, supposedly. So how he says, how would you use moldavite to make philosopher's
stone? Right. So in this instance, moldavite is now your prima materia. So you remember how I said everybody is searching for this key thing that's going to be the easiest thing they can make the stone out of. And moldavite fits that description very well because it's already crystalline. It's already got high spin state atoms in it. There's a lot of platinum, palladium, and crazy high spin elements in there. It already has the crystalline structure, and all you need to do is you basically saved about 10 years worth of work, because doing the stone is a long process, and the final stages is a 9-month process where it goes through that digestion, where I explain how you have your stone inside of the philosophical egg. And so with moldavite, you're just, you know, a couple of weeks into that, and then you can go through your 9-month digestion process. So it makes a really good prima materia, basically.
We believe that it would be very high dielectric constant, and we believe that the bubbles inside did contain, I think Teresa actually had a paper showing the platinum group metals vaporized inside the moldavite. So you get that whole metaphor we're talking about the foam inside the meteoritic glass, similar metaphor. So we think we understand the electrical engineering of it a bit more now in terms of the micro, the monatomics versus the macro, the molecular geometry.
Yeah, and that really created the environment for what became the, you know, that whole mecca in around Prague, where it was literally the central of Europe, and Rudolf II, as he gathered his whole, artists, musicians, alchemists, magicians, was just like a mecca, and that bowl, that rose bowl that was just made up of that shattered meteorite of the moldavite, just provided that field for that consciousness to come into. And if you look at Philip Callahan, he was really, really good at analyzing soils, and he showed that paramagnetism provided a conducive, conductive field for those kind of energies to come to, and really diamagnetic, or lacking the paramagnetism in the soils, provided for, you know, and that's where you see in the middle of the desert where there's drought, there's no food. The consciousness is low because everybody's fighting. So we've seen that in specific areas all over the world. He analyzed the soil in the rainforest where everything is lush and grows and everybody gets along, and then compared it to desert countries where people have been fighting for thousands of years, and said that it's in the soil. And that soil is providing, and in the moldavite's case, it's providing the field for that life force to thrive in.
That fractality, actually, and they called Bohemia, Bo was the name for the Hermetic bloodline, and it was the Hermetic Revolution, the Battle of White Mountain, Prague. It's all about this alchemic process from the short wave to the long.
Absolutely.
So I think we've done wonderfully here. Paul, I think you're to be congratulated. It was a fabulous conversation. I think this film will be a beautiful thing to share for everybody. And I'm just so delighted, Paul. I personally wanted to hear you tell a story for a long time. I'm grateful, and I think everybody here is. And yeah. Is there anything you'd like to say in closing?
Thank everybody for coming out, and really thank you for being part of this particular timeline that we're in, because for me, this is the most exciting time in history to be alive. When I was a kid, I always thought, oh, I wish I lived in the Renaissance era or whatever, and I had this, you know, real fantasy about gaining knowledge and understanding and what the philosophers were doing then, and I thought we were at a total loss, you know, back in the 70s and 80s. I just thought humanity had gone off track. And now I realize, no, this is the greatest time to be alive in the history of mankind, because now we have access to all this. The old paradigm is really fading away rapidly, so we have an excellent opportunity for some real accelerated growth in energy, in the medical field, and in consciousness, and in understanding our place and our role in the universe.
And we can take all of these wonderful ancient mythologies and bring real pure principle wave mechanic phase conjugate physics to it, and really work it out from the myth to the equation. And now we can do it. And, you know, I had some of the equations, but Paul's been our hands-on guy from the plasma to the therapy to the alchemy. So I'm just really glad to have hooked up with Paul personally. I say thank you.
Thank you. Yeah, it's been a fun ride.
It's been a magic evening. I want to thank everybody. Stay tuned. So we're going to make this shareable, probably at fractalfield.com/alchemyoffusion, and there'll be more to come. And remember that Paul and I will be back to talk about Therify in 2 weeks, and next week we'll have Alan and Teresa talking about using alchemy and implosion to invoke angelic plasma. So thank you, Paul, so much.
Yeah, all right. We'll see you in a few weeks.
And if people want to stay in touch with you, Paul.
Yeah, I had my address on that beginning slide. You can email me there. Let's go back to it. Aurelius at quantum-solutions.ca.
So to stay in touch with Paul. And Paul is the centerpiece of the Therify team as well. So lots of ways to communicate. Let's all stay in touch and alchemically have this fusion oneness experience.
Yeah.
Great
having everybody along with the ride. Bye-bye.
Thank you so much, Paul. Thank you, everybody. Take care.
Bye.
Bye-bye.